Good evening to everybody. Thank you very much to be here. So I would like to explain the difference between two versions of Islam. But before, I would like to give an overview about the teachings of the Quran regarding the place of human being in the universe next to the creator of the universe and all of the creatures, each being in the universe, and the reason of the creation of the universe and the human being according to the Quran. But before this, it is necessary to give an overview about the principle of infinite, endless, the principle of endless, how it is explained in the Quran. What does it mean? Endless, the principle of endless. As we know, it is written in the Quran, Allahu Akbar. So God is Allah, God, the creator, is bigger. Akbar means bigger, bigger than what we can imagine and what we can reason. It is bigger regarding the capacity of our reasoning and our imagination. So in the verse 44 of the Surah An-Nazi'at, it is written, فِيمَنْ تَمَنْدِكْرَهَا إِلَىٰ رَبِّكَ مُنْتَهَاهَا. It means that it is endless because it is related to your Lord. So when the experts, they are observing the space, they see that the space is endless. Space is endless. The visible part of the space is so far, very, very far point in the space, is the farthest point that one can see, but it is the visible side of the universe, which is named in the text of the Quran, Ash-Shahadat, Alam al-Shahadat, the visible side of the universe, of the existence. There is an invisible wall. Furthermore, it is dark. There is no light. So it is said it is full of a substance which is named recently by the expert dark matter and dark energy, which fills such as 80% of the mass in the cosmos. So the visible side of the universe is only 20% of the mass in the cosmos. 80% exists, but it is no visible, no perceivable. In the Quran, it is mentioned Alamul Ghaib, no perceivable, no visible. So the whole space is filled of a substance. One side, like the surface of the ocean, is visible, three-dimensional world, it is Alam Shahada, and multi-dimensional universe is Alam al-Ghayb according to the Quran. So this is just the world of the creation, which is endless by itself. And Allahu Akbar, the creator, is bigger than the whole universe which is created by him. So this is the matter of the science of physics. But the Quran gives another example regarding the principle of infinite, endless, according to the principle of the mathematics. The Quran says, the numbers, the quantity, of the numbers is endless. Endless. So you start to count 1, 2, 3, 4, X, Y, etc. Endlessly. You never reach to an end. It, infini, endless, is not a number. Endless means endless, without border, without end. Because if endless is a number, you can say endless plus one, endless plus two, endless plus three, and so on, to the cycle. So, mathematically, the numbers don't have any end. So the particularity is that in the endless number is quantity, which is endless. We have two rungs of the endless number, the pair number and unpaired number. So the pair 2, 4, 8, etc., etc., endlessly. And unpaired 1, 3, 5, so endlessly again. So inside of the endless quantity of the numbers, you have two endless categories. And the particularity of the endless is that a part of the endless quantity equals the global part. It is the particularity of the meaning of endless. So it is written in the Quran, in the Surat Ibrahim and Surat An-Nahl. Nahl is Biz. Biz, verse number 18. And Ibrahim number 34, if you start to count, to take under the calcul, the number of the numbers, you never find any end for it. You can never reach to any end. It is end. So it was people who were able to count. They were the mathematician, the Greek mathematician. So when the number is written textually as the letters, like in place of 1, you are writing Aleph. In place of 2, you are writing B. In place of 3, you are writing gamut. In place of 4, you are writing dal, etc., etc. So it is named in the jargon of the Quran, raqam. And when you are writing mathematically the number 1, 2, 3, 4, etc., etc., it is named adad in the jargon of the Quran. So those who know the secret of the letters and the numbers, they are named Ashabul Raqim, the companion of Raqim. Raqim, what does it mean? It means Kitabul Marqum, a book which is written according to the science, to the mathematical science of the letters and numbers. So, in the Surat Al-Kahf, cave, we have three verses regarding the companion of the numbers and letters. So, who knew the hermeneutical languages? The secret of the hermeneutical language and languages. So in the Surat Muhammad, the verse number 24, it is written, أَفَلَا يَتَدَبَّرُونَ الْقُرْآنَ أَمْ عَلَىٰ قُلُوبِهِمْ أَقْفَالَهُ. there is lock on their heart. Why they don't meditate deeply about the verses of the Quran. So it is the content of the Quran, the particularity of the language of the Quran. So when Prophet Muhammad was talking with the people in the peninsula of Arabia, so the wanderers of the desert, the Bedouin, they replied to the speeches of Prophet Muhammad that we are not at all interested in what you are talking about. What are you talking about? We are not at all interested in the mathematics and etc. etc. What is the interest of what you are telling me? So you are composing a lot of useless speeches to talk with us, but we are not interested to all of these things. They didn't show any interest. And they told, we don't accept what you are talking about unless you change the content of your book or you bring another. So that period is mentioned as the period of ignorance. Asrul Jahiliyyah, the period of ignorance. So in the world vision, it was a lot of quantity of superstition. And the old beliefs of the former people. And they were so much attached to the tribal traditions. And they wouldn't like to change them. And Prophet Muhammad would like to bring a new paradigm. So it was from the beginning a big wall of misunderstanding. It was not possible to communicate with those people. The door was closed. So they resisted for 20 years in front of the appeals of Prophet Muhammad. And finally, after the conquest of Mecca, they accepted to convert to Islam and to stop fighting the Quran and the appeals of Prophet Muhammad. But they told him, now we are Muslim. We integrated the Muslim community. From now, we are Muslim, you are Muslim. You have your own interpretation of the text, of the religion, and we have our own interpretation of the religion of Islam. And from that period, two antagonistic versions of Islam were born in the city of Medina and Mecca and in the peninsula of Arabia. So, Islamul Madani, the Islam to build the civilization based on the social contracts between citizens. And Islamul Badawi, which is so much attached to the tribal traditions. And the two groups are different from each other, but both of them, they name themselves Muslim. And they gather under the flag of the same name, Islam. But these two versions of Islam are like thesis and antithesis. Totally in front of each other. So it was in the period of the lifetime of Prophet Muhammad, not after the death of Muhammad, in presence of Prophet Muhammad. The majority of the verses revealed in Medina is about criticizing this version of Islam, which is named the Islam of the hypocrite persons, whose tongue and whose heart are going to two different directions. We have an entire surah in the Quran which is named Suratul Munafiqun, the surah of the hypocrite persons, hypocrite Muslims. And they are inside of the Muslim community. So one day the revelation of the verses stopped, and in 632 A.C. Jesus, Muhammad passed away. So with the constitution of the Umayyad dynasty, so another explanation appeared, Islam Qur'ani و اسلام روائی. روائی means the Islam which is based on روایات. So the expert, the doctor in law in Islam, since the Umayyad dynasty, they said that Islam, the temple of Islam is based on four pillars. First one is the Quran. Second one is Sunnah. The third one is Al-Aql or Al-Qiyas, I explain. And the fourth one is Al-Ijma'. So the second pillar, as Sunnah, includes Ahadith, Akhbar, and Rivayat. I will explain the difference between them. And the third pillar is usage of the capacity of reasoning in order to compare what is said in the Quran regarding what was happening in the period of the revelation of the text of the Quran and the things which are happening nowadays and which were not predicted by the Quran. But the doctors in law, they look at the orders which can be extracted from the verses written in the Quran to bring them, to extend them to the event which are happening nowadays in our time. So by comparison, so usage the capacity of reasoning in order to compare between the orders which are said by the Quran and the orders which we need to be said to us by the doctors in law. So it is the third pillar of the temple of the religion of Islam according to the doctors in law. And ijma means the unanim fatwa, opinion of three or five or seven expert doctors in law, the religious authority, the ayatullah, the mullah. So they say that Islam, the temple of Islam, is not based just on the Quran, but it has four pillars. And they say that the Quran is a very complicated book with complicated language, and we are not able to understand directly the Quran. For this reason, we need the sayings attributed to Prophet. Under the light of the sayings of Prophet Muhammad or the report of the time of Prophet Muhammad, we can better discover what the Quran would like to explain us. So they put in a corner the Quran and they are using more and more rivayat, the sayings, ahadith. Ahadith are the sentences which are supposed to be said by Prophet Muhammad. Akhbar, the plural version of khabar, is the report, which is given by a reporter that one day it happened something and Muhammad told something about it, etc. So they are extracting the orders, ahkam, from the rivayat, the sayings, in place of the soul of the revelation of the Quran. They invent a lot of things. such as circumcision of the girl, such as imposed veil upon the head of the women, such as the patriarchal system, no respect for the gender equality. They are inventing a lot of penal laws, such as stoning. So you don't find any trace of the stoning as an Islamic religious penal law in the Quran. And it exists as the major part of the Islamic penal law in the jurisprudence, in fiqh, in sharia. So these are the additional side of the Islam al-Riva'i, which is based on Riwayat and not Al-Ayat, the verses of the Quran. So these two conflictual Islam exist nowadays, and it is going on. So if you won't like to use the Riwayat, the sayings attributed to Prophet Muhammad, in order to understand the teachings of the Quran, how we should do? So what is the difference between Dinul Islam, Din path of Islam, Islam, what does it mean? The meaning of the word, of the vocabulary in the jargon of the Quran. The word, the vocabulary of Islam, what does it mean? What is the meaning of Selim? What is the meaning of Sogum? How to change the heart state from Sogum to Selim? What is the different steps of this process, of the substantial evolution? According to the teachings of the Quran, regarding the tradition of Abraham and not the tribal traditions. How to do that? Where we can find an exact translation of the Quran? Does it exist or not? How to do it? So we sent down the teachings regarding the therapy, the healing in the Quran. It is written in the Quran. Shifa means healing. Health, therapy, wa rahmat and misery board in this Quran. Islam Qur'ani. The Islam, according to the Quran, is based on four pillars. So Islam, according to Riwayat, Islam al-Riva'i, is based on four pillars, as I explained. According to the religious authorities, according to the clergy, according to the mullah. But Islam, according to the Quran explanation, and by taking under consideration the importance of the soul of the revelation, of the written text of the verses of the Quran, is based also on four pillars. These four pillars are janin, fetus, in the womb of the mother, from the conception of the fetus till the end of the period of 9 months and the birth of the baby. Janin. the science of gynecology is explained in detail in the Quran. Why? Because human being has a very important place in the universe. And the human being starts to be from the stage of a fetus. It is because of this. With the natural law that you cannot separate from this being, which is named Al-Bashar, Al-Insan. The children of Adam and Eve, regardless their opinion, regardless their religion, regardless their gender, regardless the color of their skin, regardless their culture, regardless their language, they are equal with each other, according to the Quran. Under the name of Islam, of Insan, Al-Bashar, Bani Adam and Nas. And it starts from the stage of fetus. To enter in this three-dimensional world, Jahan, Janin Jahan, in order to accomplish a task on the path of the substantial evolution to reach to the summit of the mountain of the perfection, Janan, Janin, Jahan, Janan, in order to get knowledge about the creator of the universe, Yazdan. Janin, Jahan, Janan, Yazdan. These are the four pillars of the temple of Islam according to the teachings of the Quran. Le chart des droits de l'homme, the human rights charter, droit de l'homme, in French language means man. Man in Arabic language is rajul. Rajul means man. The plural of rajul is rajal. Woman is nisa. The Quran doesn't talk about the rights of man in order to talk about the rights of human being. It is talking about the rights of the children of Adam and Eve. Bani Adam. Regardless of their gender. So it is written by Karamna Bani Adam wa hamalnahu fil barr wal bahr. So it means that we posed the crown of our generosity upon the head of the children of Adam and Eve. And we are bringing him, we are bringing Bani Adam, the children, everybody, regardless of gender, etc., upon the seas and the earth, the dry earth and the seas, the water. We give to this being the superiority. So the place of human being, of everybody, is the place of the representative of the divinity on the three-dimensional world. The place of Khalifatullah, Khalifa. Enni ja'ilun fil arz Khalifa. Khalifa. So each human being, regardless, so you cannot stone the representative of God. You cannot mutilate the representative of God. You cannot cut the hand of the representative of God. This is the soul of the revelation. And the human rights in the frame of the Quran.
So there are a lot to say, but so I prefer to finish by talking about the necessity to write an exact translation of the Quran. Because these translations are not good at all. And it gives a lot of misunderstanding about the teachings of the Quran. People would like to legitimize the religious violence by hiding their opinion and intention behind the name of Islam. So, the root of this misunderstanding returns back to the wrong translation and wrong interpretation of the Quran. So, it is, the most important task for the expert in Islamology, in the Quranology, to redact an exact translation of the Quran by taking under consideration the importance of the soul of the revelation of the verses of the Quran, and to put away the riwayat and the opinion of the religious authorities during the whole history of Islam. So it is written in the Quran that Ya Dawud inna ja'alnaka khalifatan fil arz fahkum baynan nasi bil adl fahkum baynan nasi bil haq. So it means that the reason of the system, the governmental system in the society is not to oppress people but to manage the society according to the importance of the natural laws of everybody, every citizen from one side, and the social contracts, which are based on the free will. So it is because of this that Prophet Muhammad broke down totally the traditional tribal laws. So the meaning of the family didn't exist before Muhammad in the Arabic Peninsula. So, Muhammad stressed upon the importance of the cell of the family in order to build a society, in order to build a civilization. So, the polygamy doesn't have any place in the teaching of Muhammad. He abolished it step by step. What is important to take in consideration is to get familiar with the soul of the revelation. Yes, there is absolutely this reality that the Quran, the evolution of the society according to the Quran toward modernity and changing the values and the paradigm are going to the same sense. Inside of the society, society is an alive being in progress, in change. And the Quran respects this change, this evolution. So what is important is the social contract between everybody with another person based on free will. So it is what is written in the Quran. The Quran explicitly gives order to write down to the illiterate people of the time of Muhammad, to learn how to write and how to read in order to reduce the contracts between them. Because he would like to build a civilization. And I add this one sentence that for many, many, many years, 13 years in Mecca and some years in Medina, Muhammad and his companions, they were praying toward the temple of Jerusalem and not Kaaba. Why? Because they oriented the direction of their attention to the model of the society of David and Solomon. It is said because in the Kaaba it was the place for the idols, it was the idol temple. But they were able to change their direction to another site and not to the temple of Jerusalem. Why they did? Because it was their utopia. It is because of this. They would like to build a society upon haq, the truth, the equality. So it is the same stream which was named the Gnosticism, and after the apparition of Islam and the occupation of the territory in which the Gnosticism was practiced, the name changed from Gnosticism to Sufism. It is absolutely the same stream. The particularity of this stream is that it is a practical school. Practical school. It is not a theological school. It is not a theoretical school. It is the practical school. It is based on working upon the heart, according to the method of Abraham given by the Quran. The Quran explains every step of the heart awakening according to the model of Abraham. So, why you don't meditate about the Quran? What is the problem with your heart? So it is what is written in the Quran. So opening the gate of the heart. The heart, according to the Quran, is composed of 7 superposed layers. That the last one is named Soveida. Soveida means the black hole. The black point. It is a tunnel between visible side of the universe, three-dimensional side of the universe, and multi-dimensional side of the universe, between Shahadat and Ghayb. So it is named Soveida. So the Sufi are using the method of the Quran to focus their attention to this point and to open the gate of the invisible world, and to get inspiration, intuition, contemplation, revelation, to reach to a stage which is named certainty, yaqeen. Yaqeen, certainty, which is based in 3 levels. Science of certainty, contemplation, certainty by contemplation, and certainty by being a part of the truth. So, ilmul yaqeen, ainul yaqeen, haqqul yaqeen. And all of these things are written in the Quran. So, everything which is said by the Sufi masters is based on the teachings of the Quran. And it is not because the Quran is the source of these teachings. It is because the Quran is the continuity of this method, which pre-existed before the apparition of the teachings of Muhammad and the Quran. Those who were practicing this method in the time of Muhammad, they were named Ashab Sufi. And after, it was the teachings given by Imam Ali and after redacted by a person who had the authorization from Imam Ali, who wrote the first exact interpretation of the Quran, but in his hermeneutical language, whose name is Sheikh Hassan Basri. So for all of the Sufis, all of the Sufi confreries and orders, Sheikh Hassan Basri is the founder of Sufism. And he is related to Imam Ali, who was related to Prophet Muhammad, who was in the continuity of the teachings of other spiritual masters who were named before Islam the Gnostic people.
So Gnos in the jargon of the Quran is Irfan. Arif is a person who is placed in a position in which he sees. This position is named A'raf. وَعَلَى الْأَعْرَافِ رِجَالُ. So in that position, there are certain people who are staying and seeing, observing the inhabitant of the hells in the hell and the inhabitants of the paradise in paradise. So it is the meaning of gnos in the Quran. There is no curtain in front of their inner eye. They observe visible and invisible side of the universe. Ghayb and shahada, and they get yaqeen, certainty. So irfan means gnos. And the difference between irfan, gnos, and science, ilm, is that science, according to Schrodinger, he gave an example about the physics quantic, and he explained that this science is based on uncertitude, the principle of uncertainty. And Gnosticism, Gnos, is based on the principle of yaqeen, certainty. This is between science and gnosis. So Quran explicitly precise that the closest community, the closest people to the Muslim community are those who say that we are Christian. It is written explicitly in the Quran. So for the Sufis, the principle of unity in the Quran and the principle of Trinity in Christianity are gatherable with each other. They can get together according to the Sufis. According to Hatif Isfahani, who is a very important Sufi master, he explained that when a lightful being appears in three mirrors, it doesn't become three different realities. The apparition, the manifestation of the beauty, of a beautiful being doesn't bring any hurt to the principle of the unity. So for the Sufis, gathering between the principle of unity and the principle of Trinity is discovered and explained. So, and according to the Quran, the closest people to the Muslim community are those who say that we are Christian. So it is very important, very, very important. And in the Sufi way, the name of Jesus and the name of Christ is more often repeated, more than the name of Prophet Muhammad himself. As the roots of the spiritual teachings of the Quran and the spiritual tradition behind the teachings of the Sufi masters.